This morning's verses all have a similar theme running through them. It is a little bit difficult with that second reading in there, but all of them have a similar theme running through them. How many of you have ever received a phone call? Y'all like that one? Like how I switched that up on you there real quick? And when you answer the phone, what do you say? Depending upon who it is, really. I mean, now with caller ID, it's like, what do you want? Or you look at the call and you're like, oh no, there's no way I'm going to answer that one. But you're supposed to answer, right? At my house, anyhow, if you call my house, if you call the parsonage, you should get, hello, the Wirtleys. Sometimes they answer the phone, though. How do we answer the phone? Hello? Right? Hello? Who is it? What do you want? Right? We've all gotten called before. Right? And that's what the theme is this morning. We get Samuel. Can you imagine it? He's laying down. I would lay down here, but I don't know if I'd get back up. He's laying down in the temple and he hears God calling, Samuel! Samuel! Samuel gets up and runs to Eli. But it's not Eli calling him. And finally, Eli figures out what's happening. He says, it's God talking to you. Go back and lay down. And then in the verse, and I just heard it this morning. Now, I've seen this in another spot that we don't talk about it, but this morning I saw it in the calling story of Eli, or the calling story of Samuel. It says, after Eli told him what was going on, Samuel went back and lay down, and then what happened? God came and stood there with him and said, Samuel. God, if God calls you so many times and he doesn't get through, he's going to come and pay you a personal visit. Yeah, you should be worried about that, actually. That could be kind of scary. And the psalm tells us, as I just told the kids, right, that God knew you before you were formed in the depths of the earth, it says. I thought that was interesting. I made comments our best about that. It's, you know, God knew you before you were formed in the earth, before your parts were knit together, God knew you. He knew the plans for your days. He knew what was going to happen. And then we see the story in John about Jesus calling Philip, and Philip and going and getting Nathanael. And Philip says to Nathanael, we found the Messiah. We found the one whom has been proclaimed to us. We found the one that is to come and set us free. And he comes from Nazareth. And Nathanael responds with the appropriate question to that. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Because Nazareth was a little podunk place that nobody knew about, that nobody cared about. So why in the world is the Messiah going to be coming out of Nazareth? And what does Philip say? Come and see. How hard is that? I'm going to ask a question, and I don't want you to raise your hand because I don't want anybody to feel shamed in doing it. But who has invited someone to church in the past 6 months? How hard is it to say, come and see? Because there's something here in this place that draws you here, right? There's something here that keeps you coming back. You're not coming back because it's just something for you to do. Because we all have something better to do, right, than to be here and to gather. Or do we? There's something here that draws you here. There's something here that brings you here. There's something here that is worth someone else coming to see. So why are we not saying, come and see? Because you see, I believe, beyond the shadow of a doubt, not only have each and every one of us been called on the phone, well, maybe some people, Kimber and Camden, obviously have not gotten phone calls yet. But at some point in their life, they will get phone calls. And not only have they received a call on the phone, but they've also received a call from God. And it's going to become completely plain and evident here in a few moments when they come up here to this font. Because Martin Luther said to us that each and every one of us has a gift that we've been given. If you are a shoemaker, then you make the best shoes that you can because people need those shoes. And that's how you proclaim the gospel, by making the best shoes that you can. See, when we think about calling, we think that only pastors are called, or only people who work in the church are called into ministry. And that's a bold-faced lie. Each and every one of us have been called. Each and every one of us, when we came to this place, received a call on our lives from God to go forth and to do His ministry. Now, does that mean that we have to do it in the church? No, because 95, 97, don't quote me on that percentage, but the majority of the ministry that we do as the body of Christ does not happen within these walls. It doesn't happen in this place. It happened someplace out there. That's why over our doors it says servant's entrance or service entrance. That's why at the end of the services now we say, go in peace, let the service begin. Because our service to God is not here. This is where we gather and worship and pray to be a part of the body, to take part in communion, to get His fillings for our lives, to connect with Him, to be one with our community, to be one with the body of Christ, as the Corinthians readings tells us, right? We are all members of the body of Christ. We've all been called into ministry. That's why you've got that little piece of the puzzle, right? Did you all get one in your hand? I've got a little piece right here. You got a little piece of the puzzle. Can you tell me what the picture is from your piece of the puzzle? Look at it real close. Can you tell me what the puzzle looks like? Anyone? What if I showed you this? This is actually the quarter of that puzzle that you have a piece for. And yes, I do know that it's the correct way because I do know what the picture is. So I know that I'm holding it the correct way. So this is what the outline of the puzzle would look like. Can you tell what the puzzle is? Even if we took each one of our pieces that each of you had here this morning, do you think we can fill it in and know what the puzzle is? It's a 550-piece puzzle. There's how many are there here, Esther? 160. So we got 160 out of 550 pieces. I don't know if we'd be able to see the full picture. Here's part of another problem. There are pieces for this puzzle in Ohio. There are pieces for this puzzle in two cities in the state of Texas. And why is that? Because this puzzle is not complete without all of its pieces. The body of Christ is not complete without all of its pieces. And each of you has a piece, not only of this puzzle, but of God's puzzle. You each have a piece, and you've each been called to go out into the world and share that peace in love and mercy and to show forth all of the grace and riches that Christ has given to you. Right? It's not about what we do in here. It's about what we do in the body out there to show forth of the grace and the wonderful things that we have to claim to God and to come together as His body to worship. So take your piece of the puzzle. Go out into the world and do whatever it is that you do in ministry to God, to the greatness of His glory, showing forth His love in everything that you do, and allowing your life to show others that there is something to come and see. So come and see what it is that God has for you, and never forget that you have been called, and He needs you to go and do what it is that He's set forth in your life for you. Thank you.